A big hello and a warm welcome to all of you amazing and beautiful people out there. Welcome to my channel, the Twin Flame Union, and this is the part 2 of the 5D, 5-dimensional union happening through 5th chakra. And also I had mentioned in part 1 that how the masculine misunderstands all positive communication of the divine feminine, also he sees it as something negative. So this happens when the throat chakra is blocked, and the time or the moment your throat chakra starts getting unblocked, becomes better and better with time, with inner work of course, you will realize there will be a big change in the way you communicate with other people, how you talk to other people, how you speak your truth. Because throat chakra is about speaking your truth. In the twin flame journey, it's extremely important to speak your truth, not be insecure, not be scared of what other people are going to think. And that obviously includes your twin flame DM. The DM gets into a negative zone because when a woman is not completely confident or she is not completely sure that a man is going to accept her for whatever she's doing in life or for whosoever she is not going to speak up fully, or she would either overspeak or she will say something else which is not really the truth, and it will come out as what she doesn't mean actually. This fifth chakra is very important because it's essential to communication, self-expression most importantly, and being creative. And if you are creative, you know that the right side of your brain works better. If you're creative, you are a more relaxed person. Your breathing is also very smooth and easy. You're not in tension. Now, I'm not saying that all creative people are the same. If somebody turns their creativity into commercial business and then has to please other people constantly, even that type of person will have a blocked throat chakra. Even though they could be, in some cases, appear successful from outside, however, they are not actually successful because inside, in their heart, in their life, they are not happy because they are not expressing their true reality. So even when they entertain people as a creative person, or they are carrying out some other work in an official setup or some other place, they would just be saying things that go in line with their work, the commercial work. In the relationship pattern, in love relationship, anyone who has the problem of a blocked throat chakra, they are going to have a difficult time expressing their truths or their thoughts. Now, we all know that the divine feminines are more spiritual in nature. They are doing the inner work, and they have also, in most cases, gone through the narcissistic abuse which is caused by the neglecting narc adult. So there are two types of abuses. One is the enabler, the enabled child, and I'm not talking about all of them, I'm talking about the ones which are most commonly seen in the twin flame journey. Because in the twin flame journey, the feminines usually are scared or they suffer from abandonment and neglect. And the opposite of that is fear of rejection, the one that sort of mirrors it well. So the enabled child is the one who's scared of rejection, and even before they are rejected, they assume that they will get rejected because they have that fear, they have that insecurity. You might think that how can an enabled child who has received so much support, so much love and so much cajoling and pampering, how do they get this type of rejection feeling? Because ideally, they should not feel rejected. They should feel very loved. That's because the narcs are always very much connected to the materialistic reality, the materialistic world. Be it anyone, most narcs are very much concerned with the outer world, with how they are perceived by other people. So even when they enable the child, they don't do any good to the child. They are going to give the child very big delusions. They will put a lot of pressure on the child for being around them, taking care of them. And because all children, you know, love the attention and affection, the child would constantly be around the adult, the narc parent or the adult, very close to them. But they basically act like their slave, their servants, or like, you know, how constantly present assistant is like. the child cannot form love relationships, the child would have difficult times, things, situations in doing all these things, you know, basic things also. And they would be in the influence of the narc adult, because the narc adult who's enabled the child cannot live without that child. Not because they love them, but because they need someone to serve them, someone to look after them, someone to fulfill their wishes, someone to bring them money, or someone to bring them luxuries of life, or anything, maybe social status, anything of that nature, which is related to their materialistic image. So you can join anything into that, whichever suits your particular situation. Okay. So this is why the enabled child has a problem. Also because when the same child goes in the outside world, okay, so inside the enabler is constantly telling the child, you're wonderful, you're amazing, the world cannot see your talent because they're blind, because they don't know and this and that. The child will go out, get bullied, not because they are bad, not because they are good, it's the opposite actually, but because they're actually bad. Or they are actually trying their skills in something that they are not good at. And what are those skills? These are the skills that the enabler adult wants to have or thought has. Because even the narc enabler has many illusions and delusions. So they put the same illusions and delusions in the enabled child. The enabled child will always have a problem in receiving feedback from other people. They cannot take criticism in a healthy way. Even if no one likes to be criticized, you know, in a group of people, they would be the ones to react the most. And sometimes a lot of famous celebrities have this issue also. A lot of successful famous people have this issue. So if you tell them that this is not good about you or you need to work here, they overreact a lot. They will hate you for it. They might even cut you out of their life. They will never speak to you again. You know, and they will try to cover it up by doing something else so that nobody talks about it or brings it up. In the twin flame ascension journey, we try to remove both these problems. The problems caused by abandoned child or the enabled child, you know, their lives and their childhood. Now, the abandoned one has other issues because, say, as I was mentioning, that they know people very well. They can read people very well. They have that empathetic nature. So when they are in this twin flame dynamic, they really want, out of love, to tell their partner or their lover that, look, I don't think this is working out very well. Or they just want to tell them anything, you know, like it can't always be very serious. It could just be, hey, the blue color doesn't suit you. Or you should not wear too much of white. Or you should not eat so much sugar. It could be something basic. It could be something logical. And it could be something just out of love, you know. Like they want to call them out of love. They say, hey, you are my monkey. Or you are my something else, little mouse. Now they could be calling them a mouse out of affection. Because maybe they like the mouse. Some people like mice and mouse or whatever. But if it's a enabled narc or raised by enabled narc, the narc who enabled them, oh my God, it would be a really difficult situation after that. They would not like it at all. Because they cannot see other people's perception. It's very difficult for them to see another person's perception, which when they heal, they realize that this was not a negative thing. Maybe they used it as a nickname, or maybe they just, you know, because they think that certain things and certain people and certain situations are only bad. So they only associate feedback and criticism with something negative. They sometimes think, they do not think that it could be something positive too. Or maybe it could help them release their own trigger. Why are they getting triggered? Say, for example, the narc adult has enabled a child to make them believe or to make them think that they are a very good singer. Why? Because the adult always wanted to be a good singer but could not be. Okay. Now, the adult is raising two kids at the same time. One is genuinely a very good singer The other is genuinely a not good singer, like a bad singer. Now, that bad singer could have some other great qualities, which will be completely ignored by the enabler. And this one, the good singer, may not be good at other things, like maybe doing maths, or maybe just ironing clothes, or whatever it is. I'm just giving examples, so you can add according to your situation. Alright? But the one who's a very good singer is an extremely good singer. So with the narc adult, one thing is a big problem. You have to be good because that's connected to their image. But you can't be better than them. Because if you're going to be better than them, they will have a problem with you. They will have jealousy and they will not like it that my own child is getting more appreciation or more acknowledgement, more praise than me. You know, instead of people telling me that your child is equally good as you, sings equally good, or, you know, something nice, some nice compliment, they'll be like, no, it can't be better than me. If someone walks up to them and says, I heard your child, oh my God, in your family, no one sings so well. But your child is so beautiful. And they're like, no one sings so well. What do they mean? I sing very well. They did not talk about me. That person didn't even notice me. Okay, so my claim to fame or my spotlight is being taken away by this child. So now I'm never going to appreciate this child. No matter how beautifully this child, even if the child sings like a canary, you know, even if the child has got natural singing abilities, I'm never going to appreciate this child. And the other one, you know, who is not that good, now that other child becomes like the favorite because, and this one is, you know, having lesser skills, some for some reason. So they will be like, okay, this is my more obedient child, this is my more loving child. Now, this child is not that good. And they know it. So they are going to keep pumping the child. You are a good singer. You are a very nice singer. You can do it. Yes, you can sing. You can sing. Oh, come on. Let's sing some songs together. So they are going to do many activities with this child. Now, maybe at home or maybe in personal situation, this child who cannot sing well is genuinely, you know, feeling good. Like, okay, getting the attention. No one minds attention. Getting all the attention of the adult. Getting to be around the adult, constantly getting, you know, that praises and wow and this and that. So the child develops a delusion. And now the child goes in the outside world looking at the other sibling because the other sibling is also going in the outside world and singing songs and this and that and the friends are appreciating or, you know, there is something going on. The child gets some kind of awards or something. So outside world will give a lot of appreciation and love to this child. But in his or her heart, the child is very sad because nobody in the house is appreciating the child. Or maybe one or two, you know, empathetic parents or grandparents or you can say neighbors or teachers, somebody is saying it. But the most important appreciation or the most important feeling of comfort and love comes from the one who gives birth. Or who takes place of the birth mother. It could be a stepmother also. It could be someone who's raised the child also. And the child feels, what is the point of all this adulation? Maybe it's not correct. So this child, the neglected one, the ignored one, will also form a delusion that I am not good enough. I am not that great. And the other one will start thinking that I am the great one. And both of them will go in the outside world. The one who is very good will get appreciated but not be happy because they don't want so many people appreciating them when not completely ignored in their closer intimate world. And here it's too much of appreciation is coming and in the outside world when they go and start singing, everybody starts making fun of them. Oh, you quack like a duck or you're sounding like a frog or you're so funny. They laugh at the poor enabled child. So the enabled child who's been getting so much criticism from other people, so many negative feedbacks, feels really bad about it. And they come running back to the adult who has said all these things to them. And instead of accepting that, yes, it's my fault, I should not have done this, they start blaming the other world. They say, oh, you know what, you were really good. Those people who made fun of you, they are jealous of you. Okay, and to the other child, they would say things like, those people who are appreciating you, they don't know anything. They got no skills either. Maybe you are just, you know, there were too many ordinary people, so you were better than them. Maybe you need to work more on yourself. So just imagine, the same narcissistic adult is capable of destroying the life of two very pure children. Okay? And they don't do it knowingly, of course. If they knew, why would they do it? So this is not to bash those people, those narc adults, because let's understand, they are suffering too. And they are probably suffering much more. So when a person is really low on self-image, very insecure about who they are, but they have created an outer image because it defends them and it protects them, makes them look very happy in front of the outside world. Such people always and also say very big things about themselves, which cannot be swallowed by many people. So they know that some people are not buying into what they are saying, but they are so confident, they'll act so confident that it would be hard to actually believe that they could be wrong in some cases for some people. And this is the reason why inner work is very, very important for anyone, because when you do inner work, you realize a clear difference is there between a delusion and reality. The illusions and the delusions, they are not the same as what's real. So both the enabled child with the help of inner work and the neglected child, both of them will figure out. One will figure out, okay, I may not be good at singing, but definitely I could be good at painting. I could be very good at drawing. I should focus more on that instead of trying to achieve something that I don't even have interest in. Maybe my parent, the one who raised me, has huge amount of interest, but that is their personal choice and that is their personal area of interest. And in life, they should independently do something about it. Because they cannot independently do anything about it, so they depend on the enabled child. The poor enabled child has a lot of pressure too. And this will affect them if, say for example, both these kids. Now one of them has become twin flame divine masculine, one of them has become twin flame divine feminine. So imagine what havoc will they go through in their twin flame journey. The one with neglect will attract someone who's enabled. And the one with enabled childhood will attract someone who's been neglected. In both the cases, they are going to play out this dance with each other. Alright, it's not very difficult to understand these things. As I said, there are other fears also, my friends. There is fear of loss, is there, and fear of commitment. So fear of commitment will attract fear of loss, the vice versa. Okay, so twin flame journey is special journey because it's like most important thing you learn in twin flame journey. When you are in love with God, when you are in love with Source, you will automatically in the three-dimensional reality, in your, the regular reality, which is in front of you, which you see from two eyes, the bodily two eyes, you will attract the right person for you. You will know who is my right person very easily. There will not be any doubt. But before that, you need to find out, you need to figure it out with your own inner work, with your own efforts, that your true love is Source and nobody else. And you will receive everything from the Source. Source is the giver of everything to you. Once you have that understanding, that connection, that bond with Source, and inner work is not like you do 1 hour, 2 hours in a day and that's it. You know, inner work should be at least, if you are awake, again I mean from the two bodily eyes, if you are awake for 12 hours in a day, then more than 6 hours at least should go into your inner work. A lot of people tell me that, you know, if I do inner work, when will I do my work? When will I make money? When will I earn? But those who have graduated in doing inner work, those who have reached somewhere in inner work, they will tell you with their own experience that we don't need to worry about anything. All we need to worry about is inner work and the rest gets managed on its own. And without us being worried and without us being troubled, without us going through stress, automatically things get managed on their own. We just have to show up for ourselves. So at least 6 to 8 hours is required in our work. And that's why we say that do Karma Yoga. Because Karma Yoga means you are doing inner work while you're doing everything else. You could be cooking, cleaning, washing, but in your mind you're doing inner work. You're practicing awareness of the mind with source integration. Okay, now mental awareness can be found with other things also, but if you do it with source, then it's the best. Nothing like it after that. So now coming to the throat chakra. So all these problems, the neglect and the ignoring part, and of course the enabling part, it creates huge blocks in the throat chakra. Okay, sometimes people have thyroid problems also. Sometimes people have physical problems also. The voice becomes very heavy. You know, the throat issues are always there, like they're coughing constantly. And, you know, they have some problem always going on. Then they'll have a lot of mouth ulcers. They will have some gums problem also. You know, these are basically problems related to the throat. When people get throat cancer, it's really, really difficult. And I have met a few such patients, not to treat them, but in general, when my father was going through some difficulty, he also had cancer of the stomach. So when he was going through that, that's the time when I met a lot of cancer patients. And the one with the throat chakra, they were literally silenced. They could not speak a word. They could not utter a word, but they would see everything. They would know everything. So it was very strange to see their difficulty. You know, so it governs a lot of important functions in our life. Most importantly, our expression. So we need to do good neck exercises every day in the twin flame journey. Those who feel that you are struggling with the 5D, you should, actually the shortcut is through solar plexus. I've always said that. If you work on your solar plexus, automatically it will, because solar plexus is capable of doing that. It can heal from bottom, it can heal from above. So sooner or later, it will heal your throat chakra because it will give you so much confidence and so much knowledge about who you are, so much, intelligence will download into you with all your inner work, with your daily inner work, that automatically you'll get a lot of power to speak your truth without trying to please others and without getting out of the present moment, without getting anxious or depressed. It's like that much fun actually. So doing a lot of neck exercises helps you, running helps you, doing some kind of physical work like a dance workout, you know, where you use a lot of hand movements. So always remember, when you do neck exercises, you should do a lot of hand movement, you know, like taking your hand up and taking it down. There are certain exercises, maybe, you know, I might just share some kind of a workout routine or regime for people who are going through these changes. You know, for every chakra you can have different exercises. So now, why am I talking about all of this? Because as I said in the first part also, it's very important for you to clear these chakras, okay, work on these chakras, because fifth dimension is connected to your fifth chakra. Now one more thing I want to tell you. Most people think that it's very easy to get into 5D union, or getting into 5D, it happens with everyone. That's not true. Not true at all. Getting into 5D union, it happens for a few people. On planet Earth, if there's 100% of population, 50, 60, 70, no. Maybe 5 to 10% people. And in the age of ascension, yes, the number will increase, maybe 20. Slowly it will increase, go on increasing till we reach the golden age. But it's not easy to get into the 5D union. And right now, in the current scheme of Earth, all those people who are going to get into the 5D union, these people will form the foundation, will found the base of those people who will follow them into the 5D union. And we all know that the base, the foundation, has to be very strong. So all those people who will get into a 5D union, or who have already gone into it, or who are in the process of it, these people are going to be extremely strong-headed people. Nothing or no one can move them from their spot. If they firm their feet on the ground, nothing can remove that feet. It will act like a very solid, huge tree's root how the roots are. Nothing can move it, nothing can shake it. You know, maybe some leaves can fly here and there. Maybe, you know, even if it's very difficult time, some branches. And this is like a tree, like a very powerful tree. It can grow, it can bend, it can swing, it can slide, it can merge. That type of thing that I'm talking about. So it's very important for all those people who are working on their 5D union to know that they are actually going to be the foundation for the other generations to come. So their work is very responsible and they need to have this kind of attitude. Without this attitude of serving the community, of being a contributor in the community, only they can get into the 5D union. Because I want to say this, and I have said this in the past also, that if you are looking for 3D union and you are doing all your inner work because you want a 3D union, it's not because you want it for yourself or you want to grow or you because you want to progress or because you have responsibilities toward the Mother Earth. You feel very deep kind of a relationship with her as if she is your real mother. As if she is your real mother. Maybe you had a birth mother and you are very thankful and grateful to her, no doubt. But to Mother Earth, you feel a very strong bond as if she is your actual mother. Or you could have, as I said, two mothers. One is the birth mother and one is the mother because of your presence on planet Earth. You have this connection with Earth and you feel the pain of Earth. This is what I have seen in some of the contributors and some of the mission-oriented people. They feel the pain of Mother Earth. Like they speak, when they speak also, they speak like, you know, how there's so much pollution, how there is all this deforestation, how children are being abused, how women are being treated. This is disrespect for Mother Earth, you know, they speak like that. So then they will get support and they will get help from the higher beings. When the higher beings, when the angels, when the spirit beings, they see the pain of this person, like how responsible they are, how kind they are, and how much they have suffered on planet Earth, how much they have suffered at the hands of people. And these people, they need to go. They need to go from Earth because they are going to spoil Earth more. And we need to bring these ones up because they genuinely care for Mother Earth. They don't want any money in return or fame or recognition or anything. They just want to do their job and die in peace, you know, whenever they have to. And these people are doing inner work, so such people never die technically, you know. They don't die. They just cross over very happily. It's like a promotion for them. So even if they know that they love somebody or there is a twin flame or this or that, there comes a point in the life of the person who's doing inner work, they get sick and tired of all this. You know, they are like, to hell with the twin flame or to hell with this person I love or blah, blah, blah. I just want to do my mission work now. I just want to, you know, whatever I'm here for on this planet, I want to fulfill that purpose of my life. Fine, I have a twin flame. Fine, I have a lover or a partner. Okay, great. So what? What am I going to do? You know, what am I going to do now? I love them, they love me, that's enough. As it is, love is not supposed to make you put glue on your body and attach to someone. We are all born with different separate physical bodies for a reason. Because the physical bodies, even though they are separate, the connection is from the heart chakra. Everyone's heart is connected to each other. So those very clingy and very dependent kind of people, they never get into twin flame union or 5D union. Because it's not possible for them to just, you know, leave that clinginess attitude in them. Or leave that codependency or being result oriented. Some people get into therapy or they get into, you know, inner work mode and they are like, when is my union happening? I am doing all this therapy work, I am doing all this inner work, but the union is not happening. If you ask them, what is a union according to you? Because some of them come to me, they are married, some of them are dating, some of them are in contact also. Yes, there's a good number of people who are not in contact and they've not spoken to their DM for a long time or DF. But there is also a very good high number of people who are in contact with the one they love, or they've gone through that phase of separation and now they both feel that they've grown out of it. They don't need to do all this blocking and, you know, going away and running and chasing. So they are doing things, but they don't know what's union. They just want to be in union with their twin flame. But what you have, maybe someone else doesn't have. Somebody who has reached to the contact phase after not talking to each other for a long time, they have reached to the contact phase, and obviously they have more than the one who doesn't have contact, or the one who's engaged has more than somebody else, or the one who's married has somebody else, but still they come for therapy work because they feel empty from within. And they say, yeah, I'm married to my twin flame for so many years, 10 years, 15 years, but I'm not happy because they don't love me. My twin doesn't love me. They don't talk about me to anyone. They don't praise me. They don't share their time with me. They probably have another girlfriend or boyfriend, or they're married to their work or something else. But I am not acknowledged and I am not appreciated at all. What do I do about that? You know, I cannot leave my husband. I cannot leave my wife. I love them too much, you know, but they don't love me back. What do I do about it? So your situation or their situation is not very different. Okay. Nobody's situation is actually any different. If you are in separation, you are in separation. Doesn't matter what is your societal status in terms of relationship. Okay. A single person who does not want to commit to anyone, that person's twin flame could be far more in love with them just because of their style of not committing to anyone, you know. But they, in their heart, obviously they have committed to someone. Why not, you know? But what is the commitment deeply to? The mission work. What is the commitment deeply to? To self-progress, to self-growth. That I want to unblock all my chakras, not just the fifth chakra, but all the chakras possible, you know, till the crown. I want to unblock all of them. I just want to be this purified being on planet Earth, you know, who has created a paradise in the world, despite all the challenges and despite all the issues. Okay, so this is where I conclude this particular part. A lot of other things you can do to heal your fifth chakra, which you can check out, like stones and crystals and this and that. But obviously here in this session, my idea is to give you the truth so that you know that a clear, fully healed throat chakra means that you are able to express who you are confidently, okay? And you are not scared of telling the world whatever you believe in, whatever you know. Your personal truth, you will be fearless about speaking your personal truth. You'll not have any problem in expressing or communicating. You won't feel anxious. You won't feel judged. Even if you feel like somebody is judging you, you come from a place after a gathering and you're feeling low for some time, that's because you're still very critical of yourself and other people. You don't believe, you don't understand that people or you could be imperfect. So we need to accept our imperfections, and from our imperfections, we need to feel perfect, you know. So it's like saying perfect imperfections, right? Perfect imperfections or imperfectly perfect. Both are correct. Both mean the same. Okay. So thank you so much for being here with me. One love and peace out.